Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the warehouse. Thank you for joining us for worship this morning. Please stand. We're going to thank God for everything He does for us in all aspects of our life.
It's always like springtime when you make it all through. Your light is breaking through the dark. Love it is sweeter than wine, bringing joy to your life. Your hope is rising like the dawn. Oh, we're coming alive in you, yeah. It's always like springtime with you. Your light is breaking through the dark. Love it is sweeter than wine, with joy, with light. Your hope is rising like the dawn. This is what you do. This is what you do. Make me come alive. This is what you do. This is what you do. Make me come alive. This is what you do. This is what you do. Make me come alive. This is what you do. This is what you do.
Thank you. You can sit down for a second. I have a few announcements. I want to remind everybody, first and foremost, that our regular schedule is going on. The times for that are in the bulletin. If you are attending Wednesday night supper, please call and make a reservation for that. I want to thank everybody yesterday that helped with the Feed the Need event. I really want to encourage everybody the next time we do one of those to come out. On many levels, it's just a great thing. It shows our church is active in the community. We help a lot of people, and we really have a lot of fun doing it every time. So pay attention to those. Maybe I can get Stanley to agree to do another one sometime in the future. But we gave out yesterday about 500 plates of food, and Wayne had gotten hold of some dry goods and food to be cooked, and we gave some of those out. And Calvin even took some out on the van and gave them out to some people. But it was a great event. To me, anything that shows a church in action is what we should be doing. Read the New Testament. Jesus did not say, go ye into the world and have a seat in church and sing and listen to sermons every week. He told us to go out in the world and serve the world. And it was a great opportunity. So next time we do one of those, I want to really encourage everybody to do that. I want to remind everybody that we have communion today. If you didn't get a cup, if you raise your hand, Wayne will get one to you. We do communion here. We have an open communion table. Everybody is invited to participate. You don't have to be a Methodist, a member of this church, or any church. We just want you, if you're comfortable, and that's the way you want to worship with us this morning, to do communion. Cody is going to be leading communion this morning, so he'll make sure that you know what you're supposed to do at the appropriate time. Wayne, there's one here behind Stanley, Tony in the back, and then a couple here on the, your right, my left. So Wayne will get those to you. One special announcement I have this morning is our drummer Calvin has a birthday today. Now, I'm not going to tell you how old he is, but we discussed it this morning. He's 60, so we decided it was not quite old enough to be in the Rolling Stones, but pushing it. So we want to thank Calvin for being a loyal member of our congregation and our band. So make sure you wish Calvin a happy birthday if you see him after the service. Doug Collins is here. He's our SPR chairman. That's a fancy word in the Methodist Church for our personnel committee. So Doug's going to come up and do an announcement for us, and then we'll move along with the service.
We've got a new preacher coming. His name is Peter Vermullen. He has a very interesting resume. He grew up in South Africa. He has a doctorate of ministry in spiritual formation. He's been a counselor. While he was in Cuthbert, he worked as a psychology professor. He's currently at Louisville United Methodist Church in the Northeast District of our conference. We appreciate Keith and Peggy's ministry here, especially Keith's leadership in this past year of challenges, and we wish them well as they live on the Dublin with their ministry.
Thank you, Doug. And Doug, just to clarify, those changes take place in the middle of June, is that right?
Yes.
Okay. Just to remind everybody, for the offering today, there's buckets and baskets on the back table. If you want to put money in the buckets, we use that for missions. We bought the money. We bought the food for Feed the Need out of that yesterday. So if you want to give to missions locally, your money goes in the bucket. Your regular offering to the church or your tithe will go in the basket. You also have an opportunity to give through Venmo on your phone, and the address is up. So we're going to do one more song for you this morning, and then Keith's going to come up, and then we'll follow that with communion. Please stand with us.
There's a grace when the heart is under fire. Another way when the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between me, where I used to be and the second in, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There was another in the water, holding back the sea. Or should I ever need reminder of how I've been set free? There is a cross that bears the burden, where another died for me. There is another in the fire. There was another in the fire. Forget beneath the water. No longer a slave to my sin anymore. Should I fall in the space between what remains of me and its reckoning? Either way, I will bow to the things of this world. There is a grave that holds nobody, and the power lives in me. There is another in the fire. Whoa, there is another in the fire. Whoa, there is another in the fire. Whoa, there is between us. There is no other name but the
someone came and stands between all the things I see and the reckoning. And I know I would never be alone. Yeah, I know I would never be alone. The reason my love ain't my fire that's standing next to me. There is another in the waters that's holding back the sea. And should I ever be reminded how good you've been to me, I've got the joy of every battle. And I know that's where you'll be. There'll be another in the fire that's standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters. Holding back the sea. Should I ever be reminded how good you've been to me? I've got the joy of every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. There is another in the fire. Whoa, there is another in the fire. Whoa, there is another in the fire. Whoa, there is another in the fire. Whoa. 60 years old, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, y'all can have a seat. If Keith will come up, please.
Got it, brother. Very good. Very good. Thank you, man. Beautiful. Thank you for being here this morning. And Doug, I appreciate your good words. And Peter Vermeulen, I think, is how it's pronounced. And you'll get used to that as he comes and ministers to you. He's a wonderful pastor. He loves God's people, loves God's church. And I know that you'll have a good tenure here serving as a pastor of this church. Keep us reminded to pray for Ozzie Deason's family. Of course, he passed away just recently, so we want to pray for Leah and Prime and Jane and Vic and all the family members. And the Feed the Need went very well. I think we served over 500 people. Is that right? At least 500 plates were served, and we appreciate everyone who came out to help with that, especially you, Stanley Harvey. You put a lot of work into that, but thank you. All right, our scripture is from Habakkuk. You almost have to clear your throat before you pronounce that. Habakkuk 3, 17 and 18. Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vines, though the olive crop fails and the fields produce no crop, no food, though there are no sheep in the pen and no cattle in the stalls, in the midst of total economic collapse, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The Sovereign Lord is my strength. And this is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Well, every Rotary Club I have attended goes through the very same ritual at the end of every meeting. All Rotarians stand and repeat what they call the four-way test. Of the things we think, say, or do, is it the truth? Is it fair to all concerned? Will it build goodwill and better friendships? Will it be beneficial to all concerned? Most Rotarians can say that from memory. I'm thinking there are some here who could say it from memory. Raise your hand if you can say it from memory. Okay, Jenna, others of you. Those are good things for all of us to consider. But also, as Christians, it's important for us to affirm our Christian faith, to embrace the Christian teaching of my life. I want others to know the one in whom I have placed my trust, by the way I live my life and go through the storms and trials of life that will come my way. Well, this morning, I want to highlight for us what I consider to be three of the most outstanding examples of believing and trusting in God. These people didn't just recite a creed. They endured through the most horrible times of sadness and darkness only by trusting in God. First, there is Job. As bad as any day you or I might have had, it does not compare to the bad day that Job had to endure. You might recall, on the very day that he gets word that his oxen and donkeys have been carried off by a band of thieving, traveling merchants, he hears that a lightning strike has killed his sheep and all of his hired shepherds. Then he hears that all of his camels have been stolen and his servants attending them have been killed. And lastly, he hears tragedy of all tragedies, that his sons and daughters, while feasting at and drinking at his oldest son's house, were caught in a sudden tornado that collapsed the house and killed them all. It is a mind-boggling, heartbreaking bad day. Dropping our son Matthew off at school, North Georgia, hundreds of miles away, seeing him wave goodbye to the very last second of visibility in the rearview mirror made it one of the worst days of my life. I can still see his face. But I would not trade that bad day or any other bad day I've experienced for any one day in Job's life. When we drove away from the college, I had the hope of seeing my son again. We're so fragile, aren't we? And vulnerable. And yet sometimes we want to appear so strong, but we're really fragile. When Job hears of his tragedy, he tears his robe, he shaves his head, he falls on the ground and does the unthinkable. He worships God. The Lord gave, he said, and the Lord has taken away. May the name of the Lord be blessed. Well, later, Job's body breaks out in painful sores from head to foot, most likely a result of the emotional and mental anguish that he was experiencing. His wife apparently has had a breakdown. Perhaps disgusted with God, disgusted with Job, she says to her husband, "Are you still holding on to your integrity? Curse God and die." But Job replies, "You're talking like a foolish woman. Shall we accept only good from God and not trouble?" And when tragedies come to a family, it most often puts pressure on the relationships in that family. And I would suggest counseling to anyone who has endured that or is going through that. And I'm planting a seed thought in your mind for the future. And there are some resources I can get in touch with nearby. Ken Myers can help us find the right resource for you. But anyway, later, Job's friends show up to sympathize him and to comfort him. They see him at a distance. He is almost unrecognizable. And what do? They begin to weep. They feel his pain from a distance. The Bible says no one said a word to him because they saw how great his suffering was. Perhaps you've been there in the presence of a hurting friend and you have no words to say. You might remember the story of the little girl who is home, gets home from school very late. She explained to her mother she was late because when she passed her friend's house, she learned that her friend's bike had been broken and she stopped to help. "Well, honey, you don't know anything about fixing bikes. How could you help her fix her bike?" "Oh, no, Mama." I didn't stop to help her fix her body. I stopped to help her cry. Job's friends are very good friends when they are silent and sensitive to his pain and just sit there and help him cry. It's when they think they have something to say and start talking that they make their mistake. Oh, this is what makes presiding at a funeral so difficult. I am convinced that the preacher's words have much less impact on a grieving family than the simple presence of friends and relatives who show their love and concern just by being present. I often flip through the channels of my car radio, and I'm sure you've recognized as well how one little slight turn of the knob and you're taken into a completely different culture and world. I heard a song that you might have heard with these words. I don't even know what they mean, really, but in the context of the song. But I heard these words, and I thought they were very meaningful. You say it best when you say nothing at all. You say it best when you say nothing at all. It's when Job's friends begin to speak that they make their mistake. They attack Job by explaining how all the troubles in life were likely his own fault. And here's Job's response: though God may slay me, yet I will hope in him. Well, this traditional translation of the text has been challenged by the context, by manuscript evidence, and a few nuances in the language. But I accept the NIV, the ESV, and the King James Version on this. It reads, though God might slay me, yet I will hope in him. It reflects the same trust we read about in the first chapter. The Lord gave, the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this, Job did not sin or charge God with wrongdoing. Job has lost everything, everything he owns, all of his children, one day. And yet he falls to the ground in worship. His body is racked with pain. His wife discourages him and challenges him to give up and die. But Job remains faithful, and he defends God's honor. His own friends turn from their sympathy to making accusations, and yet Job says, even if God takes my life, I will put my hope in God. Everything has turned against Job. All of nature, it seems, there's lightning, there's a tornado. His own wife, his close friends, and even his own body seems to self-destruct. And regardless of it all, Job worships God, defends God's honor, and holds on to God. He never gives up believing God, hoping in God, trusting God. Many of you have prayed for Ozzie Deason and his family. You've prayed for Leah and Prime, and daughter and son-in-law of Jane and Vic Warren. Ozzie's little body had been stricken by seizures and assaulted with bouts of pain all through his short life. Indescribable pain. Pain that rifled through all of his family members. His mother, Leah, has tried to keep friends and family informed with periodic updates and requests for prayer. I visited at Jane and Vic Warren's house just recently. And Jade told me that Leah ended every very often heart-wrenching update on Ozzie with the same words that some of you have read. Even still, God is good. For centuries, theologians, Bible scholars, have tried to make sense of all the suffering that Job had to endure. Much of it remains a great mystery. No one can explain it. But in the end, everything is made right. All evil set to destroy him is conquered. The favor and the blessing of God that he provides Those blessings are remarkably multiplied, and they shower down upon Job like a steady afternoon rain. And recall God's opinion of Job. Have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. I pray that God will find me faithful to the end, regardless of my suffering and my circumstances. I know without any doubt, no doubt, hard times are coming. For every one of us, it's just a matter of time. Regardless of how pleasant life might be for us in the present moment, and even if we escape any number of calamities along our journey through life, we will all have to walk through the valley of the shadow of death. May we learn to trust God, believe in Him, depend on Him, live for Him, worship and bless Him regardless of our temporary suffering and circumstances, because even still, God is good. Well, the second outstanding example of believing and trusting God, and I'll get through these a little more quickly, Daniel's three friends. They had been exiled to a foreign land. They had been forced to change their names. They were put in the service of the king, the very king who was likely responsible for destroying their homeland and possibly killing their families. King Nebuchadnezzar was so full of himself, so arrogant and proud, he set up a golden image, an idol, and he demanded when certain music was played that everyone bow and worship the golden image. He was a control freak, not unlike many of our politicians today. And even though threatened with death, Daniel's three friends refused to bow to the image. The king is furious with rage, gives him one last opportunity to bow and worship, or else be thrown into a blazing furnace. And in the face of this threat, they address the king. O Nebuchadnezzar, we do not need to defend ourselves in this matter. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, the God, the one true God we serve, is able to save us from your hand and will rescue us from your hand, O King. But even if he does not, we want you to know, O King, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold that you've set up. Now, please take note here. That one response is the very best way to get thrown into a fiery furnace. Okay, just in case you're wondering. That's it right there. Well, the king turns up the thermostat on the furnace about 7 times its normal temperature. And then he has these three tied with ropes and tossed into the flames. And the fire's so hot, the ones who toss them into the fire are consumed by the flames and kill themselves. And when the king looks into the furnace from a distance, he sees not three but 4 men walking in the fire. And the fourth is the Lord, or his angel. That's all I want to know. That's it. That's all I want to know. That's all I need to know. When I'm facing the heat, God is in here with me. Now, this is where the words of the song the band sang a little earlier. There's another in the fire standing next to me. Brother, that's all I want to know. King Nebuchadnezzar is overwhelmed. He calls for the three to come out, and they're found to be, listen to this, untied, unharmed from head and hair to clothing and foot. And the Bible says there was no smell of fire on them. You can walk into Kibo's and walk out and you smell like a barbecue pit. You walk into Debbie's restaurant and walk out and you smell like fried chicken. How do you go through a fire and not smell like smoke? God was protecting these three. They trusted God. King Nebuchadnezzar acknowledges the God that they serve And I pray that my trust in God might rise to such a level, even if God does not rescue us, O King, we will not worship any other gods. So let's prepare ourselves and encourage each other to remain faithful to the one true God in the midst of the social and cultural pressure around us, pressing us to conform to the ways of the world. May we remain faithful to God. And lastly and briefly, we must consider the life of the prophet Habakkuk. One of the great examples of trusting God. He speaks to God about his sadness and grief over the violence in his country, Judah. There is no justice. The courts of law are perverted. Those who are trying to do right are penalized and punished, and those who are doing wrong are rewarded and go free. And consider the news you've seen and heard lately. It seems that many who are doing right are penalized, and those who are doing wrong are rewarded and go free. And we all know what some of that's like. It seems like the fabric and the seam that's holding our nation together is unraveling in some places. And Habakkuk questions God, "What are you going to do about this, God?" And God says to Habakkuk, "You look at the nations and watch and be utterly amazed, for I'm going to do something in your days that you would not believe, even if you were told." And God allows the Babylonians to destroy the Assyrian power, unheard of. And then he allows the Babylonians to invade Habakkuk's nation of Judah as punishment for all their violence and injustice. And Habakkuk, of course, questions God, "How can you let a nation that is more unrighteous to invade us?" And God says, "I'm going to deal with them too." Habakkuk is full of fear, describes himself like this: "I heard the words of God, and my heart pounded, and my lips quivered. Decay crept into my bones, and my legs trembled." The righteous judgment of God is about to be unleashed. He has a right to tremble. But he goes on to say this: "I will wait patiently for the day that God deals with our enemy." And he speaks these memorable words: "Though the fig tree does not bud, and there are no grapes on the vine, and the fields produce no food, no sheep in the pen, no cattle in the stalls, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in God my Savior. The Lord God is my strength. Though there are no pecans on the trees, Lanier, no cotton in the fields, no peanuts to harvest, no corn on the stalks, I will rejoice in the Lord and be joyful and acknowledge Him as my strength." What do a husband and wife say to each other when they stand at the altar and make a covenant and a vow of loyalty to each other? For better, for worse. In sickness and in health. For richer, for poorer. To love and to cherish. Till death separates us. It's a vow of loyalty to each other. Habakkuk is vowing his loyalty to God. Two little boys are talking. One says to the other, "I was in a wedding the other day, and I learned that we men can marry 16 wives." "Really?" "Yeah, really. Four better, four worse, four richer, and four poorer." Habakkuk is the testimony of a man who believed God, trusted God. And like Job and Daniel's three friends, regardless of the circumstances, would not let go of God. God is sovereign. God is good. Who else is worthy of our trust? Bill Gaither's song, the choir, sang some months ago, "Gentle Shepherd, come and lead us. Help us find our way. Come and feed us We need your strength from day to day. There is no other. There is no other we can turn to who can help us face another day. Regardless of the troubles and trials, may our trust in God grow stronger. For better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in sickness and in health. Frances Jane Crosby, this last story. Fanny Crosby, as we call her, perhaps the most prolific songwriter to have written songs. She wrote over 8,000 hymns. We have 7 of them in our hymnal. They'll sound familiar to you. To God Be the Glory, Jesus Keep Me Near the Cross, Blessed Assurance, I Am Thine, O Lord, Rescue the Perishing. She was born in Putnam County, New York, March 24, 1820. A poorly trained doctor applied a mustard plaster and poultice to her eyes when she was only 6 weeks old, and as a result, she became totally blind. But even in her childhood, she demonstrated a mature faith in God. She said, I have a jewel that is called contentment. And I really think that's what most all of us want. Not another thing, but contentment. When she was 15 years old, she entered New York Institute for the Blind. And she was so remarkable as a student. At graduation, she was hired to teach, remained on the faculty for 11 years. But listen to what she wrote when she was 9 years old. Friends, blind at 6 weeks, but at 9 she could write these words. Oh, what a happy soul am I, although I cannot see. I am resolved that in this world contented I will be. How many blessings I enjoy that other people don't. To weep and sigh because I'm blind, I cannot. And I won't. May God give us this same gift of contentment. Teach us to trust Him more each day. May we be faithful to Him in the midst of our suffering, in the midst of social pressure, and in the midst of societal breakdown all around us. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Cody will now come and lead us in our communion ritual. You'll take your packet and prepare for the Lord's Supper.
New covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice, in union with Christ's offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith, Christ has died.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. May them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by His blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ and one with each other, one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory, and we feast at His heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit and your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, if we could have the Lord's Prayer, say that together. Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Packet.
Fred, the Jews represent the suffering of Christ, represent the blood, represent the broken body. Our Lord God understands everything that Habakkuk had to endure, everything that Daniel's three friends went through, and everything that Job had to face. And He understands everything you and I go through in this life. Take this to your comfort. You'll remove that top covering. Take the bread, the body of Christ, broken for you. Thanks be to God. You remove the second covering. The cup of the new covenant in Christ's blood poured out for you and for men for the forgiveness of sin. Thanks be to God. The band will come now.
I want to remind everybody, it's in the bulletin, but and we'll put it on the social media. But next week is Mother's Day, so number one, if you have forgotten that, hit the gift mart or wherever you need to go, Amazon. But I also want to let everybody know we're going to have a breakfast next week after our service to honor our mothers at 10 o'clock in the social hall. So make sure you come to that and you invite your mother or grandmother to join us for worship next week. Please stand as we close the service.
God, in the midst of our
suffering and sadness, help us to trust in you. In the midst of social pressure to conform to the ways of this world, oh God, help us to trust in you. In the midst of societal breakdown reported in the news every week, help us to trust in you for better, for worse, in the strong name of Jesus. As you go, dear friends, may God go with you, before you to guide you, behind you to guard you, below you to uphold you, above you to inspire you, beside you to befriend you, and within you to give you peace. Amen.